Good morning. It's a great looking group out there this morning. I want to welcome you to Southwest Christian Church, those in person and those who are online. Just an exciting time to be with the Lord this morning. I'd like you to stand, invite you to stand, that is. And we're going to pray, then we're going to enter into a time of worship. Father, we just give you glory and all honor, all glory and all honor. As we worship you this morning for who you are our creator, you are our provider, you are our savior through your son Jesus and his blood. And Lord, we just thank you so much for that mercy, for that grace you give to us as we accept you, Lord. I pray for your wisdom here, your direction today in this service as we worship you. May everything that we sing, the words we say, be done for your honor and for your glory. Lord, I thank you for those who are here this morning, Lord. I pray your blessings upon them. Just speak to all of us, Lord. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. I think you might know this song. It's been around for a few years.
There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Power in the blood.
Amen.
In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Spirit, Lord, we've come. We're gathered together to lift up your name, to call on our Savior, to fall on your grace. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Spirit, Lord, we come. We're gathered together to lift up your name, to call on our Savior, fall on your grace. Hear the joyful sound of our offering as the saints bow down, as your people sing. We will rise with you, lifted on your wings, and the world will see that our God saves. Our God saves. There is hope in your name. Morning turns to songs of in the name of the Son, in the name of the Spirit, Lord, we come. We're gathered together to lift up your name, to call on our Savior, to fall on your grace. Hear the joyful sound of our offering as your saints bow down, as your people sing. We will rise with you, lifted on your wings, and the world will see that our God saves, our God saves. There is hope in your name. Songs of praise, our God saves, our God saves.
Yes. Thank you.
A thousand generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who've gone before us and all who will believe will sing the song of the ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all power and positions, your name stands above them all, and the angels cry. Creation.
Hear your people sing.
Hear your people sing.
Excited today? Good day to be in the throne of God, worshiping an almighty God. And you know what? It's Eclipse Eve. If you haven't heard about it, it's Eclipse Eve. There's something amazing going to happen tomorrow, starting at about 12:44, ending here about 3:07, somewhere in there, from start to finish. Pretty cool. Something that we're going to witness that some of us may not ever witness again. Our kids might see it, you know, but it's going to be pretty neat. And speaking on that, you know, last Sunday was Resurrection Sunday, but the week ago Friday was Good Friday when they crucified Jesus. And most of you know, but if you haven't read it in the Bible, you know, on the day of the crucifixion, he was crucified about 9 a.m. and at noon, it says the whole earth went dark. From noon to 3. So, and at that time, you know, is when God, you know, turned his back on Jesus, because Jesus had all the sin of the world on him at that point, and God could not look upon him at that time. So the world went dark at that time. So tomorrow when that happens, I think it's about a couple minutes before 2 to a little after 2, we're going to be in total darkness here, which is pretty cool. And my thought was, during that time, is what if it never gets daylight again? You know, so just thinking on things. It seems weird that it's going to happen, because it doesn't look like anything's changed. We got all these people coming in, they say, to stay here and witness it. But anyway, I think that's pretty neat. But keep that in mind tomorrow when you're watching it with your family. Kids are out of school or whatever, or if you're driving, pull over out of the way so you don't get hit. But think on those things about the darkness, when the darkness hit the world when Jesus was crucified. We're going to be kind of similar to that, but only for a few minutes. So keep that in mind. And the main thing is, you know, the world's been talking about this, you know, is it the end times and all of that? Is it the end of the world? We are in the end times, yeah. You know, we are facing the end of the world. If it comes tomorrow, so be it. Bring it on. The point is, are you ready for the end times? Are you ready for Jesus' return? If not, you can be ready today. This opportunity's here. We welcome you into the Christian family, if you so be it. The verses I've chosen today is out of Psalm 95. And based on, we serve a big God. God has got this. He knew all this was going to happen way before we were in this world. So I'm not worried about it. Bring it on. So Psalm 95, come let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the mountains' peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he has made it. His hands form the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord, our God, our Maker, for he is our God. We are the people of his pasture and the flock of his care. So as we prepare for communion today, let's remember what Jesus has done for us. And as I said last week, you know, we celebrated Resurrection Sunday. And without that, then all of this is pointless. If Jesus didn't rise from the dead, then what we are doing is in vain. But he did. So I welcome you to participate in communion, to celebrate his death, burial, and resurrection for the rest of us. Let's pray, and then we'll take communion together. Father God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the ones that's here. We thank you for the sacrifice of Jesus for our sins. Father, just be with us as we go through this experience tomorrow, Lord willing, and help us to use it as a time to witness to others. Just be with us and go with us. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Go ahead and take your communion at this time. Go ahead and say a prayer for our offering. Father God, we thank you for all the blessings of life you've allowed us to enjoy. Thank you for providing our needs and providing the funds needed to glorify your kingdom. Just take these monies, these offerings, use them to your glory. In Jesus' name I pray.
Take my name. Love is my redeemer, lifting me up from the ground. Love is the power where my freedom song is found. There ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. There ain't no grave trumpet sound.
Boy, I was just thinking to myself, I might hear a trumpet tomorrow when the eclipse happens. Blowing my trumpet. Hey, I love what Dave was saying up here, because however you view the eclipse tomorrow, it is a moment for believers in Christ to worship. The Bible clearly says in Genesis chapter 1 in the Hebrew language that God would put his signs that mark those things in the sky, that we would see those signs and wonders. And there's a lot of speculation throughout history that if you take and backdate those stars and things, that when Jesus was crucified, that an eclipse took place. That when the city of Nineveh repented after a 5-word sermon and everybody surrendered to God and started to repent, that there was an eclipse that had taken place at that time. So however you view it, we know that it is a sign. Whether it's a sign of something that's getting ready to happen, a lot of supernatural events through history have been kind of correlated with the different eclipses that have happened. Bottom line is, and the way it was said during communion meditation, we as Christian people are ready to worship and serve the Lord God Most High on all occasion, but especially on an event like tomorrow. I want you to keep that in mind. Let's pray, and then we'll jump into our study for this morning. Father God Almighty, we bow in worship, honor, and glory to you. We surrender ourselves here and now, our minds, our thoughts, our hearts, that we can worship you and join together in the study of your word. Thank you so much for revealing that truth to us. Thank you, Jesus, for showing us that and the example. Thank you for your signs, the stars and the wonders of your creation. Thank you for these men and women. I pray your blessing and hand upon them all. Lord, that we would see and know you clearly this day, that we would repent and walk anew and fresh in you, and that Holy Spirit, you would use us however you see fit. It's in your almighty name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Well, we're starting a series today called From Ordinary to Extraordinary. We'll really be focusing on the 12 lives of the disciples and how God selected this group of men from just ordinary situations, you know, that they weren't necessarily anything greater or extraordinary at the time. And so I want you to think this morning, have you ever felt out of place in church? You don't have to raise your hand necessarily, but what I'm asking is, has there ever been a time? Just a few months ago. Actually, it's not even been that long ago. My wife and I got the opportunity to go worship in a church family right on the cusp of downtown Chicago. And going in, we both felt like we were old. You know, the average age of the church family was right around 25. Guess what? When they started praising the Lord Jesus Christ, it was the same Jesus. And while we may have not have felt, you know, that we fit in age-wise, we fit in with the praise to the Lord and Savior Jesus. What I want to encourage you in this morning, if you ever feel out of place in church, or maybe you don't feel like you have something to offer to church or this moment or to worship or whatever the case is, praise God. That's great. I love it. Reason for that is, as we study through this next few weeks, probably a few months, looking at the disciples, these fellas were nothing extraordinary. Matter of fact, it was their ordinariness that qualified them to be God's servants. And we're going to read as we go through this, Jesus' ministry, as far as revealing and the miracles and things, took place within a period of about 3 years. 3 years. 3 years that changed the entire outlook of the world. And his time of training these 12 men, you know how long that was? It wasn't 3 years. It didn't happen all of a sudden. It was about 18 months or a year and a half that these ordinary fellows, some of them fishermen, some of them, you know, whatever, all these guys, he trained them in a period of a year and a half and then set them free to be the stars of the church worldwide. Well, I just heard Dave said it's going to start about a little before 1, and then the main thing is around 2. Can we look at it that whole time, Dave? Just stare at it? Wear glasses. I'm not sure, buddy. Well, we can ask when we go back next door. So when we think about this, God took these ordinary people. Anybody feel ordinary in here? Let's see a hand. Do you feel ordinary? All right, praise God. That's good. If we're ordinary, then God can use us. So we look at this. There's with the 12 ordinary men. Jesus did not choose 12 extraordinary men to follow him. He chose 12 ordinary men to make extraordinary through him. Hallelujah. This next part that we look at says Luke chapter 6, verse 13 through 16. Calling of the 12 disciples. When morning came, he called his disciples to him, and he chose the 12 of them, whom he also designated as apostles. Simon, which is listed always as the first one, Simon, who he named Peter, his brother Andrew, James and John, which were also brothers, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Thomas, James, son of Alphaeus, Simon, who was called the Zealot, Judas, son of James, and Judas Iscariot, who became a traitor. And then I'm going to read another section of scripture that talks about the calling of the 12. Mark chapter 3, verse 13 through 19. Said Jesus went up on a mountainside and called to him those he wanted, and they came to him. He appointed the 12, designated them as apostles, that they might be with him, and that he might send them out to preach and to have authority to drive out demons. These are the 12 he appointed. Now, as we read down through this list, I want to see if anybody catches the difference as we read through the names this time. It says, Simon, to whom he gave the name Peter, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, to whom he gave the name somebody want to say that for me? Okay. Anyways, that name up there, which means sons of thunder. Sounds pretty cool, doesn't it? Andrew, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Thomas, James, son of Alphaeus, Thaddeus, Simon the Zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. You notice any difference in the names of the 12? Because we find that in Scripture sometimes. Yeah, so in this listing, the name was Thaddeus. Anybody catch or pay attention to the first listing that would know what name was excluded in the second one? Judas. There was two Judas listed in the first list. So, bottom line. When we read through that or we look at commentary study on it, it says that Thaddeus and Judas were the same guy. Just like you might have a couple of Randys in a church family, that you might start calling one of them by their middle name. Boy, bonus points. Who knows the middle name of the preacher up here today? Anybody? All right. So you might start calling me Leroy. That's my middle name. Did y'all know that? Leroy. I love it. Now, I've always kind of been like, oh, Leroy, come on. But to me, it's sentimental. Reason why it's sentimental is because my dad's name was Roy Lee Steele. So they made my middle name Leroy to put my dad's name all together as one. So while you might make fun of me all, okay, you won't. Thank you. Thank you. But, hey, they might start calling another person by their middle name because of them having the same first name. And so if I was Judas and another Judas betrayed the Son of God and had got him crucified on a cross, I would probably want to go by a different name. All right? And so that's where we see maybe Thaddeus, that was another one of his names or his middle name. Same 12 guys. As we go on, it says it doesn't matter who you were, what you did, or where you came from, Jesus can change your life and use you for his purposes. Thank you for us here this morning. That's good news. Doesn't matter our educational backgrounds, economical backgrounds. Doesn't matter our traditions or what people group we come from. Doesn't matter any of those things. Doesn't even matter how much sin we've committed or not committed. God can take it all, reuse, and make us new and change us and develop us into his great available use and tools to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. Matthew chapter 10 said that these 12 were called to, he called his 12 disciples to him and gave them authority to drive out evil spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. Now, how does that sound to you all? What does that sound like? Does that sound ordinary? You see people doing miracles, casting out demons, doing all this kind of stuff. No, that's the definition of what we call extraordinary, supernatural. And this is what God said. He was calling these 12 and giving them the power to be able to do these things. Now, one of the books that we're going to be looking at some of the statements out of is this book right here called The 12 Ordinary Men by John MacArthur. In his book, he highlights these different disciples and the differences of each of them. Over this span of time, we're going to be looking at people that were very outgoing. Any outgoing people in here? Loud and boisterous? All right, a few of you. Okay. And then two of you are quiet, backward, don't want to be noticed, talked to, any of that kind of stuff. Anybody like that? We're going to look at some disciples that were like that as well. God brought all that motley crew together for his great glory. In his book, John MacArthur said, they spanned the political spectrum. One was a former zealot or a radical determined to overthrow Roman rule. We got any zealots among us today? Probably closer to the elections we might see it. But another, I'm going to pass it on, but another had been a tax collector, virtually a traitor to the Jewish nation and in collusion with Rome. At least four and possibly seven were fishermen and close friends from Capernaum, probably having known one another from childhood. The others must have been tradesmen or craftsmen, but we are not told what they did before becoming followers of Christ. Most of them were from Galilee, an agricultural region at the intersection of the trade routes. And Galilee remained their home base for most of Jesus' ministry. Not as some might think, Jerusalem and Judea, which was the political and religious capital of Israel. You catch all that as we read down through that list? Let's just take it today. If you're a farmer, a fisherman, how does the world look at folk that are farm country boys? Which I'm a farm country boy. I grew up in farm country. I grew up baling hay. I grew up wrestling pigs, all that sort of stuff. How's the world look at people like myself up here? All right, maybe strong. Strong of back, but not of mind usually. Whatever, you know what I'm trying to say is that sometimes the world might pass this over and say you don't have a whole lot to offer. I know I grew up doing those sorts of things. I grew up in school, in a small school. I was in special needs class as far as speech therapy and things of that nature because I couldn't speak well. Even up all through my senior year, I had to take speech therapy. And so a lot of people would have just excluded me. Matter of fact, I remember the first time I went back to my high school and saw some of my teachers after I had gone to Bible college, and they asked what I was doing. And I said, oh, I'm studying to be a preacher. And they said, you got to be kidding me. One, because I was a little ornery going through high school, so they didn't really think that that would necessarily fit me. And then two, I wasn't much of a speech person or speaking in front of people. And yet God tends to take those things and make us ready to what we're available to. What I'm trying to tell you here is, as we look at this listing of the 12 disciples, they were discounted by most of the world. They wouldn't have been considered the great leaders of the Christian movement or the church of Jesus Christ. And yet God took these 12 in a period of 18 months and turned them into the leaders of his church. Next portion I want you to see here as we read on from what John MacArthur said. He said, this means these few men whose backgrounds were in mundane trades and earthly occupations had little more than 18 months training for this monumental task to which they were called. There was no second string, no backup players, no plan B if the 12 should fail. As we're going to look through these coming weeks, I want us each to understand, whatever your background is, however you find yourself in this church building, God has a plan for every single one of us. The main attributes that he's looking for is people that are available, humble to his call, and willing to be used by the Lord God Almighty. The question that's going to be asked over these next few months is, are you available and willing to be used by God? Do you want to be used by God? Are you listening to his calling? Are you willing to let him work through you. Do you feel that? Maybe it's something we pray on. Let me pray it right now before we go any further. And let's pray about this. Lord God Almighty, we bow in honor and glory to you. And as we study the lives of your disciples, we know that you take ordinary people and you make them extraordinary. God, we want to be those people. We want to be available to you. We want to humble ourselves in your presence. We want to lay down our sins before you to be made pure and holy by your blood and the price that you paid on the cross. And Lord, we know that you can do extraordinary things through us as you do your great and miraculous works. So God, I'm praying right now that you pour out revival in us as a church family to be used for your glory and for your purposes. It's in your almighty name, Lord Jesus Christ, we ask this. Amen. As we continue on, we talk about instruments in the hand of God. We all know that maybe we don't all play instruments. As we've seen up here today, there was some piano playing going on, little guitar, some drums. Can everybody play the guitar? Everybody in this room, everybody plays guitar, right? No, we definitely don't want me up here leading on guitar. I can play a little bit, but not a whole lot. Maybe a trumpet, I could do that. But a trumpet, we know, won't do any good unless somebody blows through it. It's only an instrument. Now tomorrow, Nature Trail folk, if you hear the trumpet blaring, it might be me. Because I like to mess with people. But if you hear it resounding through the entire city and all across this earth, that's not me, okay? Everybody understand that? We know that an instrument is only as good as the one that is working through it. The Bible describes in his disciples that they were the instrument and that it was God Almighty that was doing the mighty work. As we look through these 12 men's lives and we look at our own lives, we want to understand that it is God, his beauty, his glory. It is Jesus Christ that is to be glorified. When we do the works of the Lord God Almighty, we praise and give glory to him, not ourselves. So as we look at this next part of what it says in the Word, well, actually, we're going to give you another quote here. It says, Jesus sees the potential in you even when you can't see it in yourself. You know, you ever think about that when you're looking in a mirror? And I think about things like this all the time. I'm easily fascinated. All right, so tomorrow's eclipse, that will really fascinate me. But you can ask my wife after service. Our morning conversations about the things I was fascinated about today was shaving. Shaving's amazing. I mean, literally, I had all these stubbles, and I put shaving cream on, and I took this little razor, and they just came off. And now my face is smooth. That's fascinating. Not everybody else is fascinated as I am. I'm easily fascinated. When we read a statement like that, that God can take, well, like this next one, it says, God's power is made perfect in our weakness. When we read statements like that, God uses you, he uses us for his glory and honor. Do you know why? Well, one, every person in this room and everybody outside this church building has been created in whose image? Well, God's. Literally, God's image. Your characteristics, your soul, your spirit has been created in the image of God and is made to glory, to give glory and to worship the Lord God Almighty. So when we are worshiping, like in a place like this, or we're worshiping in our workplace, that's why we feel complete or we feel whole, because we're doing what we were made for. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 26 through 31 says, brothers, think of what you were when you were called. All right? So I also want you to think about for yourselves. A lot of you in this room have claimed Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Think about that moment. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many of you were influential. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. As we get ready to read that next verse, I just want you to think on the 12 disciples, fishermen, farmers, a zealot, tax collector, people that maybe had not, people wouldn't look on and think anything great of. Think what it was like when those men were preaching the gospel, when those men were performing miracles. Think what the Pharisees, the church leaders, they saw these guys that had no religious upbringing like that. They may have been taught some things, but they weren't brought up like those Pharisees. And yet, here the crowds were coming to them to hear the message of Jesus. How would they feel? Well, let me tell you. Any of you ever deal with jealousy in this room? Maybe? Time or two? Now and then? Just me? Okay. I can handle that. But, you know, we think of the issues of jealousy. Our focus has to be on the Lord Jesus Christ. In the church, in God's kingdom, we'll see God doing amazing things in different parts of his church throughout the world, community, state, country, whatever it may be. We have to stay on our task, praising the Lord Jesus Christ. And remember what old Guthrie Veach, the president of St. Louis Christian College, said? Always be ready to say something good about the Savior or the bride and his church, because that's what we are. So if we as Christian men and women are getting jealous or see other situations that are going good and maybe we don't feel like we are, don't lose sight. And again, just a reminder, if God calls us his bride or the great, and he's the great bridegroom, anybody married in the room? Some of you have your spouses in here. So let me say, husbands, if somebody says something bad about your wife, what's that usually mean? All right. That's usually what's going to come. Is those are fighting words, or you're going to try to stand up for their honor. If we can understand that on a human level, think how much so more God Almighty. If we're saying something bad about his bride, which his bride is the church, and we as Christians are saying bad things about other churches, even within our community or state or our country here, think what we could be facing. Just a little something to think on. Last part of what it said in those verses, verse 28 through 31, he chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. It is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us wisdom from God, that is our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. Therefore, as it is written, let him who boasts, boast in the Lord. And that is our boast. That's what we boast in. We boast in the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what we're about. We proclaim him. We worship him. It says here, God uses ordinary people to do extraordinary things. So don't discount yourselves. You know, I'll say a phrase sometimes, and my wife probably ain't going to like this one. But, are we okay? Now, she'll get discouraged, or she'll say something about, you know, how she feels she looks that day or something of that nature. And I'll say, hey, quit talking bad about my bride. I don't like people putting down my bride or my wife. Isn't that true, though? Sometimes we tend to be the people that talk the most negative about ourselves. Think about whose you are, who you belong to, who has ordained you and set you apart for his purpose and consecrated you with his own blood. Yeah, Jesus Christ purchased us and brought us back. He paid the price for our sins. And yet for us as Christian men and women here today to get down and discouraged, and you know, I know those things will happen, but keep in mind, hey, I belong to the Lord. I am Jesus Christ's son. I am his child. I have been put here for a purpose and a reason. Y'all need that pick-me-up today? Well, don't we all? It says here, God's work is done through ordinary people, but with extraordinary results. And man, ain't that a great reminder? You know, sometimes we feel like we're just kind of going through the motions, or sometimes it feels like we're just attending church week after week, or not really seeing any change or things happening. But yet, if we stay faithful, we're going to see those extraordinary things happening. And I know I sound like I'm beating a dead horse. Anybody ever beat a dead horse? I don't know why they say that. But anyways, I sometimes feel that way, but when we look at the work that's being done through our feeble efforts across seas, and we see what God's done, how's that happened? God does extraordinary things through ordinary people that claim him and worship him. Stay faithful. Remain true. Hang on. Trust him. Step out in faith. God's got great plans. Sometimes we can't see it. We don't know what's coming tomorrow. We don't see how it's going to work out. But we're going to hold on to the one we know who does. And the last part we're dealing with today is, what's that smell? Now, don't get nervous. I'm not talking about smells in the room or anything of that nature right now. I'm talking about what the scripture says about smell. And we know in the Bible, a couple of quick quotes here for you. When you walk closely with Jesus, you will experience a joy and a purpose that surpasses any worldly measure of success. And along with that, we will, as closer we are to Christ, the more we're going to be like him or smell like him. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14 through 17 says, "But thanks be to God, who always leads us in the triumphal procession in Christ, and through us spreads everywhere the fragrance of the knowledge of him. For we are to God the aroma of Christ among those who are being saved and those who are being perishing. Verse 16, to the one we are the smell of death, and to the other we are the fragrance of life. And who is equal to such a task?" We just want to say real quick, do you catch what that means or saying? For us that are in Christ, to other believers, you're going to have the smell or that aroma, that goodness of Jesus. But to those who are perishing or apart from the Lord Jesus Christ, what does it say you're going to be the smell of? You're the smell of death, or the reminder of what they might be facing. Bottom line is, we're supposed to be more and more like Christ each and every day as we're growing in him. We're going to smell more and more like him, which is the fragrance of life, but we're going to be death to those that are perishing apart from him. It goes on to say in verse 17, "Unlike so many, we do not peddle the word of God for profit. On the contrary, in Christ we speak before God with sincerity, like men sent from God." Why are we at this? Why do we do what we're doing? It's not because of what mankind looks at or trying to peddle something or sell something. We're in it because of the relationship that we're in with the Lord Jesus Christ. It says when God calls you, he equips you. He doesn't expect you to do it on your own. Bottom line for us, it's those that are available. You know, I can't see inside your souls or your spirits today. You ever feel like I can? Let me tell you, that's the Holy Spirit working. That's not me. But God, you know, we sometimes feel like that. But I can't see that. God can. And God knows if we here today are available. If we're sincere, he knows who can be used. The key to success in God's kingdom is not ability, but availability. And then Charles Spurgeon put it this way, "My faith rests not in what I am or shall be or feel or know, but in what Christ is and what he has done and in what he is now doing for me." When we think through all this, if we're questioning what we could be used for or what is my purpose in church or what can I do for his kingdom, remember what Spurgeon said there. We reflect on who Jesus Christ is, his greatness. And, you know, we ask that question many a times in this place. And then in a scale of that 1 to 10, how righteous of a person do you feel like you are? Well, we know if we're thinking on just ourselves and our own goodness, but that scale probably ain't going to answer very high, maybe a 4 or 5. And as I said, if you really feel positive about yourself, maybe a 7. Most people are going to say 2 or 3. But if we ask the question about Jesus Christ, of course our answer is going to be, on a scale of 1 to 10, how righteous and holy is Jesus? Yeah, he's a 10 or far beyond. You know, we're going to say that. And then we come back to, in Christ, when I confess Jesus, when I surrender my life to him, when I am born anew again and baptized in him and walk in relationship with him, I put on the righteousness of Jesus Christ. So on a scale from 1 to 10, how righteous am I? Well, if I'm answering that way, I'm going to say 10, absolutely. And that's where our minds and hearts have to be. This quote up here says, "It's never too late to start following Jesus and making a difference. Do you believe that today? You know, as we go through this study, we're going to be studying about what we got to offer, how we can continue to see God's mighty hand work. We may only have one day left to do it, if tomorrow is the day. But I'll give you a little hint. It probably isn't tomorrow, because if we all think it's tomorrow, that's not the day. It says in the scriptures that it will come in a day and a time and an hour when we least expect it. Bottom line, as Dave put it, there has never been a people on this earth that have been closer to the end time than we are. We are in the latter days. The Bible teaches that when Jesus Christ died, rose again, that the church was in the latter days of his return here to earth. What we ask is, are you ready? If it was today, are we ready? If it's tomorrow, are we ready?
Yes.
Amen. Let me pray over us and we'll go ahead and wrap up here this morning. Father, we just give you the praise and honor and glory. We know in and of ourselves we have questions, confusion, thoughts, troubling thoughts sometimes of our importance or self-worth or how we can even offer anything in our family or church. But God, we know we're created in your image, in your likeness. We know that those statements and those thoughts are lies from the devil to try to discount us or keep us unavailable or not able to do your work. So, Lord, we bow before you once again. We lay down our sins before you, and we ask for your forgiveness. We pray for your cleansing power and healing. We pray for a renewal in our minds and hearts to recognize that you are the source of our hope and truth, that it's your identity that should be our identity, that we are your children, the children of the Almighty God, the sons of you, Lord Jesus. Help us to see that, to know that, and to embrace our identity in you, Jesus, your righteousness, your holiness, for your sake and glory and your purpose here on this earth. Lord, may we see more and more come to you and know you as Savior, Jesus Christ. We ask all of this in your almighty name, Jesus. Amen. As we get ready to sing this last song of invitation and decision, I'm going to ask you to pray. You'll be praying as you sing. If you want somebody to pray over you here today, I encourage you to do that. If you need to claim Jesus Christ, get new and right, start of it, before the eclipse tomorrow, I pray you come forward and do that right now. So please stand as we sing.
Come as you are, come and drink from the living water. They flow from his hands, flow from his side. Come as you are, come and bathe in the healing water. Cleansing from sin, releasing new life. Draw near to him, and he'll draw near to you. He's been waiting for you call on his name, so come, come as you are, come as you are, come and drink from the living water. They flow from his hands, flow from his side. Come as you are, come and bathe in the healing water. cleansing from sin, releasing new life. Draw near to Him, and He'll draw near to you. He's been waiting for you to call on His name, so
amen.
There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
There's power.
Precious blood of the Lamb, in the precious blood of the Lamb, in the precious blood of the Lamb.
God bless you. May God's peace be with you this week, grace and love in your heart. May He guide your steps in Jesus' name. Amen.